so we have to remind people, by definitions, are you doing science? Are you doing mythology? Are you doing philosophy? Are you doing mathematics? So that was an important reason. Also, we gave the historical timeline that you won't need to. Somebody had asked, do I need to know that? No, that's just to kind of give you a context for what philosophers were studying and whereabouts in time on the historical timeline they lie. The big questions, what were they? What is everything made out of? What? What are the... What is the ultimate principle or arche of everything? And what is change and motion? These big questions aren't necessarily new, but the way in which the Presocratics are answering them, is it new or old? Something new happening.
Yes.
They're not using story or mythos, they're using logos. What does arche mean?
Principle of rule.
Right. Four elements. And we see that now this isn't in terms of story that you're trying to explain things, but in terms drink the number two, can you pour it into a glass? Can you smell it? No, it's an abstract immaterial entity. Now you can illustrate it showing, oh, look here, two pens. That's not the same thing as number two. That's something illustrated. And also, therefore, their understanding of knowledge would not be restricted to your senses. The purist is going to say you can only know what your senses deliver to you. A rationalist is going to say no. Your knowledge is grounded out and justified in terms of rational principles. Now, have you ever seen or heard about this in politics? Pendulum? Swinging from one side to the other? So what happens in American politics? Democrats get in for a while, and does it stay that way forever?
No.
What happens? Then there's a reaction to, it goes, then all of a sudden it's Republicans for a while, and then what? It's just back and forth, forever, straight into hell. Aristotle says, when the stick is bent crooked in one way, people don't tend to correct it by putting it straight. What do they? They overreact and they go the other way. Let me give you an illustration. How many people have seen the movie The Prestige? How many people know about the Victorian age? Steampunk. Now, what's interesting in these movies, in the books, in the literature, in the age, the Victorian age, you have a rise in spiritualism and the occult. Why do you think that's happening? It's a reaction to something. Aristotle is saying that the right way is always the middle way. So that means that occultism and spiritualism, seances, tarot cards, and turning your coffee upside down to read to your coffee grounds, is, in Aristotle's view, an overreaction to some other type of extreme. So it's not as if the extreme was, well, people were just attending church so much and they just got fed up with it. And so they went into the occult, supernaturalism, spiritualism. It was something else. So maybe perhaps the middle ground would be a moderate religious belief, going to church or something like that. But that isn't the extreme that they're reacting to, the pendulum. So if over here you have the occult, spiritualism, and seances, what do you think the extreme over here is that it's reacting to? Yes, radical materialism and empiricism. It's exactly the scientific revolution comes in. That's why I mentioned steampunk. Everything's in terms of mechanisms and machines and stuff like that. It has taken the life out of nature. Everything is a machine. Animals have no life. You can just break them into mechanics. Well, that might not sit well for people. But instead of bending the stick straight, what do people tend to do? This happens in the history of thought and philosophy as well. Between, like I said, you could be a moderate empiricist, a moderate rationalist, perhaps some combination. But when you get these extremes, you have this kind of infighting of radical empiricism, then you get a reaction, a pushback. You know what? We do that with our parents, right? Our parents have certain ideas about the way you should be, what you should be doing, and a philosophy of life. And what happens when we become about 17, 18 years old? Get out of here. Get away from me, right? Keep your ideological baggage to yourself. instead of, remember in mythology, the gods are determining everything, moving everything. Science is not providing supernatural explanations like gods moving all the items around and objects and people. It is now saying there is something inside the seed, the acorn, that's moving itself. Okay, if you're immersed in the myth, you're going to go, what are you talking about? Well, you're going to have to condescend and say, okay, let me put it this way. It's full of gods. And they go, see? You get. So they have to use this sort of language. Remember, they're breaking out of the myth. But they can't completely sever it. Otherwise, the conversation is going to be incommensurate with that society. They're not going to understand what you're saying. So that's why they're using this kind of language, is they're breaking from the myth and they're developing science. So what he's saying is there is a natural principle in things that make them move and live and grow. They're not being moved by the gods. Now, how does somebody understand that? Again, in mythology, it's full of gods. Or the magnet is alive. Really? Why would you think that? Because it moves. Only things that move are alive. This isn't alive. It has to be moved by something else. But doesn't it look, now it's going to take centuries or a millennium later for science to develop the concept of electromagnetism. That actually it's not alive. There's some force in there that force that makes magnets move iron. But you can see that they're trying to train those immersed in the myth to break from it by using this sort of language. So I'd say because his fundamental principle, because his arche is not gods, it's water. And water is an empirical element that he's an empiricist. Now, his pupil is student, and that's same way. So let's say I have a right angle triangle, equilateral, isosceles. I could even put different colored triangles. If I come up with a good definition for a triangle, hopefully I'm not going to end up with things like this in there, correct? That I don't want to talk about or refer to, or trees or people. And I'm hopefully not going to leave a triangle outside. So a good definition is going to include everything that's within that set and exclude everything else. So what is it that triangles all have in common? Three sides. No, they don't actually, because these don't have right
angles. Well, I mean, they all have a geometry.
Yes, they all have. Now you're getting really good. So it's a three-sided geometrical figure. Well, it can't just be three. That's a three-sided figure, geometrical figure. So as you correctly pointed out, it needs to be enclosed such that it makes angles, and angles that add up 180 degrees. Voila, you just defined universally the definition of a triangle, a three-sided geometrical figure whose angles add up 180 degrees. And by creating a wonderful definition like that, you've excluded circles, people, cars, smells, food. That is a good definition. So things that are finite are definite. They have boundaries. They don't keep going. The box doesn't just keep going forever and ever. There's a limit to, well, aren't all physical empirical things exactly like that? They're definite. You can touch them. You can taste them. It doesn't keep going on forever and ever. So the negation of that concept is simply to say the infinite, unbounded, Arion, limitless. Wasn't that a movie?
No,
Bradley Cooper.
Oh, yeah, that was
amazing. NCT. How to become smarter. This is whole concept of like smart drugs and stuff like that. Just hilarious if you like come down cars. It's always like, oh, I'm getting smarter now. What was my name again?
Should have told it.
What's that?
Was it posted?
Yes.
It's like the name, and then after it, I don't know if you noticed, it's just that hard part that he corrected it.
That's right, he did. Now I don't know what kind of moral mess that is. It's like, are you addicted to heroin?
Well, you just need to moderate.
Which is really funny, because actually one of the problems with addiction is an obsession with trying to control. So alcoholics will hide.
Oh, here's my little glasses. Right there. Did I say that? I know you'll find that. So maybe a little later.
They hide little things. It's an obsession with trying to control. So yeah, it was an interesting concept. Okay, correct. Anaximander's arche is the infinite. What do you think? What category do we put him in? Is he an empiricist or is he more of a rationalist? Yes. Can you touch, taste, and smell the infinite? No, that's a concept. Notice he's pushing back from his parent, his teacher. Why? Because physical again, aren't you saying what explains the definite is the definite? What is that called? What kind of reasoning is that? Saying is that if somebody asked you what is a book, it's really tautological as a form of circularity. If somebody says what is a book, you respond, a book's a book. Have you gained any new information? You haven't learned anything. So you don't get an explanation when somebody just repeats it back to you. So this is really what explains physical, all physical reality. Which is very much like just going on an infinite regress of explanations. You're absolutely right. I see you saying that. So, nobody's experienced the infinite. You can't. But that doesn't mean that you can't know that it exists. For example, this is what's important about negative language conceptually within philosophy. It becomes important also in theology. There's a lot of true predicates and statements that I can say about this object here. It's certainly not my wife, correct? That's a true statement. That's neat. It's not my car. It's not one of you students. All of these are true statements, even though I may not know what that is. Isn't something going on very similar with the infinite? When you say, what explains physical empirical things? Well, we can't have more of the same. Well, then what are you going to do? I don't know what it is, but it's not finite. It's that's probably what's going on in Anaximander's reasoning, is that he realizes the failures of his teacher Thales of not putting the question mark down far enough. Therefore, what seems to be somewhat correct in his reasoning out that I don't know, but it's definitely not more of the same. It's the infinite. That's the fundamental explanation, arche, of everything. And you see this throughout the rest of his fragments. If the nature is everlasting, does not grow old, it's deathless and indestructible. Now, this is something that comes up in Immanuel Kant. This is a concept, an idea, the infinite. Can't taste it, touch it. And source. These are all the top scholars that write for these peer reviewed for the most part. So, thoughts or a concept, an idea without content. For Immanuel Kant, content is sensible experience, something sensible. So, I have the idea of a pen. I don't know if that's real. I don't know if it's nonsensical. Until my content, my idea has content with a sensible experience. Okay, I have this idea of pen, marker, and now I have a physical experience of it. And so now I have a coherent, real idea. I think that one could apply a Kantian critique. And examined it. That's a vacuous idea. I don't know if it's real. No more real than a purple flying unicorn. Okay. How do you know if that's a legitimate idea or concept or something that's real? Now, I'm not contradicting myself by saying I have an idea of a purple flying unicorn. That's not like saying I'm a married bachelor. My brother's a married bachelor. Well, that's a contradiction. That can't be. We know that's not real. There are no married bachelors. But what about pink flying unicorns? Well, I don't know until I have some type of sensible content that I can attach that concept and idea to. Might one say the same with Anaximander's RK is the infinite? How do I know that's not just a figment of your imagination? I have nothing sensible to plug into that idea of the infinite. Legitimate critique? Maybe. Which might be the reason why his student Anaximenes in 550 BC pushes back. Sometimes, this often actually happens, not just sometimes, when you break from your parents or your teacher, you learn all the values and ideas, but you want to establish your own autonomy and identity. So sometimes you may take certain things while rejecting the other and synthesize your ideas in a new way that's your own. Now I have individual ownership over this idea. It's mine. Something similar goes on with Anaximenes. What is his arche? Infinite air. This is going to come up in the quiz. Make sure, some people say air. yes, I see where you're going, but that doesn't seem to be real. So we need to plug in some type of sensible content into the correct idea of the infinite being an archetype. But it would just be an unreal figment of your imagination, he thinks, unless it corresponded to something physical and real. So I think that's what he does. In principle, he's agreeing with his teacher, but he's saying, guess what? You didn't put the question mark down far enough, smarty pants. You need to plug some type of sensible content in there so that it's a real idea and not a purple unicorn. What do you think? A lot of this speculation we're having to work, again, we don't have the original writers, so we're really having to get into the spirit. We have to pretend like we're Presocratics or people in this age. And how are they thinking about this? Might this not be? And through dialoguing and talking this out, we get, it's exegesis, really. It's getting a way to understand what the text is saying and what the author is saying. Will we get perfect knowledge? No. We're separated by 2,400 years and very different cultures and times. And so we have to do the best with what we have. And I think that's one way to do it, is to work through. To fill a bug, you have to think like a what. To fill a Presocratic, you have to critique Presocratic. Good question. Other questions? In the professor's office, and there was only four of us. And every day we'd come in, he had the French press. We'd just sit around his office, drink black coffee. Right? I'm going to go to grad school. Not every professor is probably like that. So when looking into grad school, you better ask them, do you provide French press coffee? If not, I don't want any of your garbage. Yeah, I don't want your education upon me. give me a belief. Your belief might be true, might be false. Let's see if you get it. Who wants to go first?
Or
who said that? Wow, you got it. That's amazing. Huh. 40 marbles. Do you know that? Or was that a lucky guess? See the difference? True beliefs. You happen to have a belief that ends up being true, but you lack something. You lack justification. Proper evidence. Now, if I asked you, how did you come to that true belief? And you said, well, unbeknownst to you, that was actually open, and I was counting and watching as you were putting in the marbles, and I counted 40. Now, might not that be knowledge? You have a true belief with justification. Plato says, I don't care about belief. I don't care what your opinion is. I'm not in the business of opinions. Philosophers don't care about people's beliefs and opinions. Psychologists do. Put you on the couch, and they're really not, a psychologist is going to say, that's a wrong belief. You're not epistemically justified in, maybe, I don't know, maybe some of you. But a philosopher like Plato is going to say, I don't care about beliefs. I am in the business of trying to find knowledge. Knowledge needs to be a true belief with an account, with a logos, with justification. With that word, logos again. So this is really what I brought all that up as sort of a pretext for explaining the first fragment of Heraclitus. It's wise not listening to me. Why? Because I'm just perhaps full of opinions. What do you need to listen to then? Don't listen to me. Go find the truth yourself. Where's the truth? Logos, reason. That's objectivity. And that's why I said philosophy is aimed at finding objective truths and not opinions. You don't care about opinions. Not as while we're doing philosophy. Okay. What is Heraclitus's arche? And you can associate that arche with one of the four elements. So if you can name what his arche is, and then tell me, out of all the four elements, what's most like that arche? You want me to go back on the slide? You got it. Change. Now, what of the four elements is... Absolutely. What of the four elements is most... First is seawater, and is measured in the same proportion as the floor of the earth. Let's see. Oh, it was the previous one. All things are exchanged for fire, and fire for all things, just as goods for gold, and gold for goods. Here's a state. So we're going to have to unpack this. Remember, this is like cryptic, strange fortune cookies that we're going to have to try to understand. The sun is new every day. Now, I encourage you not to take the fragments literally. So if we were to take that fragment literally, that every day you wake up and see the sun rising in the east and setting in the west, is what he's saying the sun is new every day is because there's a magic man down here in the cosmos, and he has a grab bag full of sun. He says, you know what? I'm going to trick these guys. They're going to think that it's the same sun, but I'm throwing a new sun up there. Just keep lining them up. Is that what he means? The sun's new every day?
From our perspective, the rising is putting in the sun new every day. So when the sun comes out back from the sun,
okay, but what's being modified there? Is it the sun is new or the day is new? trying to get to kind of, I think, more of an abstract idea. Maybe number 15 will help. Changing it rest. So rest is stability. Change is the lack thereof. You've heard this phrase. The only thing that's stable, the only thing that doesn't change is the fact that
there is change.
That is not really what he's saying. So let's apply that to you. The sun is new every day. Yes, sir.
It's not exactly the same sun that you saw yesterday. It's a slightly different set of change.
Absolutely. I mean, if you think about everything, yeah, you're not even saying your cells are changing. And not only that, everything that could be said and predicated of you is true. I'm in the room at this time, and there's a bird flying by the window. All the different things, is that ever the same? No. The next day, so there's a tree here, that flock of birds might not be there. You might be in a different position. So that leads us to number 7. It is not possible, okay, and we have to take this metaphorically, to step in the same river twice. Now, why is that just literally impossible? Can I step in the same river twice?
Because water comes up moving through the rivers.
Right. So if the river's moving downstream, that space that you're stepping in, if you try to step in it again, where is it now? Down the river. So there's three things in this metaphor that we need to identify with. What in this analogy is the river in our life, world? What is the stepping? What is the stepping? Or what is the foot? Is a very tricky issue. We'll actually have a wonderful lecture on time with philosophy, science, and physics. But modern physicists tend to think of time as almost something like it, like a river, it's like some type of substance in which events happen in. But for the ancients, time is not something out there. It's not extramental. Time is the measurement. Of things moving. tree. Okay, not 100 years. Somebody burned it up. Gone. Can we know anything? This is going to set up for Plato. This is why I'm bringing this up. So keep that in mind. Let's get into, keep it on the back burner so we don't get into Plato. So what, in the analogy, the foot, are you going to use the step in the river, or your thoughts, your statements, and the river is reality, and the river is constantly changing. So you keep trying to, in fact, the pupil of Heraclitus said, the master,
isn't it true that you can't even step in the river once?
It's like, bravo! Get the gold star. Yeah, that's correct. If you really want to take it to its logical conclusion, you can't even step in it once. It's everything's in flux. Okay. He's called Heraclitus the Absurd. He gets this motto, this nickname. Because how many people have heard of an argument called a reductio ad absurdum. In mathematics, we call them arguments by via contradictions. Speaking of, how do I know that all triangles' angles add up to 180 degrees? Is it because I measure it? I guarantee you, if you measure those angles, it's not going to equal 180 degrees. But that's just because maybe I'm not that great at drawing. And if I can get more precise. Well, you'll never get precise enough. It'll always be a little bit off. That's because that's simply an illustration of a triangle. That's not a real triangle. A triangle is an abstract idea. So how do I know that? Well, I could do is Euclid, the father of geometry, did a reductio ad absurdum. A reductio ad absurdum assumes the opposite of what you want to prove. Let's assume that angles A, B, and C are greater than 180 degrees. What I want to prove is that they're equal. So a reductio ad absurdum will assume the opposite. Okay, it's greater. If in your reasoning you then therefore get to a contradiction. And remember, we defined, that was why it was very important, we defined the three fundamental laws of thought. The third fundamental law of thought was the law of non-what? Something, let's call it an X, cannot both be A and not A at the same time in the same manner of speaking. So if I get to, in my proposition, X equals A and X does not equal A, that is a contradiction. And by definition, contradictions are false. Contradictions are absurdities. So what we can do in reasoning is to take somebody's argument or take the supposition and reduce it to a contradiction or absurdity. And then Euclid goes, well, maybe it's less. And he does it again. He reduces it absurd. Process of elimination. It's either greater or it's less or it's equal. It's not greater. It's not less. Therefore, the angles of all triangles equal. The sum of the angles equals what? Isn't that interesting? So now you know what an absurdity is. It's a contradiction. And let's find out why people were calling Heraclitus the absurd. Can you find an absurd statement in here somewhere? Changing at rest. Fire lives the death of air, air lives the death of fire. I don't know if that is. Let's find a better, like, one that's more clear. I think you're onto something, but thank you. And you'd have to say, well, do you mean by alive and dead in the same sense?
No.
I'm equivocating. Then you're not contradicting yourself then. But if I say, in both senses, I mean by dead, not alive, the same sense that alive, so my dog is both dead, not alive at the same time, in the same manner of speaking, then you would get contradicting yourself. So oftentimes it seems like somebody's contradicting themselves. And what we have to do is use distinctions and flush that out. And distinctions is the road to knowledge. Let me put it this way. You're all the same. Well, maybe. In what way? Oh, let's harken back to all men are created equal. And by men, we mean humans. Well, I'm looking around the room, and it doesn't look like we're equal. We all have different skin color, hair color, talents. So, how do you qualify that statement? We're all equal in what? We're all human beings. You made a distinction to avoid a contradiction, and by doing so, you did philosophy and acquired knowledge. Isn't that nice? So, what's spectacular about Heraclitus, even though he's being called the absurd and seems like he's making contradictions, what he's doing is he's setting up a framework to allow for Aristotle to come up and create the science of logic. The tools of reasoning and thought that allows you to discriminate, to make distinctions, and acquire knowledge. So he is a foundational figure within the history of thought, because it's through these statements that people go, wait a minute, down and up can't be the same. Well, really? If I tell a see, going back to your question, you have this dialectic. He thinks that all of nature is one. It's going to be the same as Parmenides is saying that. Everything's better. But that one road, the one is the real reality. But it's seen from different perspectives. That is the dialectic. A and not A. The synthesis, reality. This comes up in Hegel. Problem. Right and left. Solution. Synthesis. And then another one. Dialectic. Back and forth. And you even do this in your reasoning as well. You have a sort of dialectic. Thesis, antithesis.